lovely Calimaris, this is Calimara here. Today, we are going to be redesigning and rewriting Osana Najimi from Yandere Simulator. If you're new here, I've been doing a series where I reimagine Yandere Simulator to make it more compelling to play as a story. Previously, I have done videos where I revamped Ayano and Taro. I highly recommend you guys check those videos out first because I've got a bit of a storyline going on. So you might need some of the context in those previous videos if you don't want to be completely lost. You don't have to, but it's probably going to put more things into perspective, I guess. Like in my previous videos, I will be evaluating the character based on their design, backstory, and impact on the game's story. I would also like to clarify that when I say I'm fixing these characters, I don't mean it in a fixing art kind of way. I'm not trying to say, oh, this is drawn badly, I'm going to draw it better, and this is the only way to do it. I think the original art made for Yandere Simulator is drawn very well. And I also think the artists who drew them are very talented. I'm fully aware that they were given specific instructions on how the character should look and what style they should be drawn in, so I'm not saying that there's anything wrong with that at all. What I am trying to fix are those directions that they've been given for the characters. Essentially, I'm not fixing their appearance. I'm just setting the story that is being told through these characters. Ayano and Taro definitely got the most significant overhauls, because despite being the two main characters of the game, they also got the least amount of design and story direction, which severely needed amending. However, the rivals are actually given stronger design and story concepts, some much more excessively than others. So, I'm mostly just taking those ideas as foundations and implementing them in my own storyline. Some rivals, design-wise, are a bit weaker than others, and Osana is definitely one of those rivals. Now, to give credit where credit is due, I actually like Osana's color scheme a lot. She has this persimmon color palette that I personally love, which I think is also very unique in a character. We don't really see it that often, so I knew I definitely had to carry that over in my new design. I also think she has the most substantial connection to Senpai, and thus the best reasoning for why she would fall for him in the first place and become a rival to us. Where she falls short, though, is everything else. Now, I personally am not the biggest fan of tsundere's. I kind of hate them, in fact. I think they're obnoxious, unlikable, two-faced, and every time I see those close-up shots of them frowning or puffing their cheek out while blushing around their crush, I want to shove them in a sack and throw them into a lake. Seriously, if all the tsundere characters in every anime were stuffed into a truck and driven off a cliff, I would not be sad in the slightest. Not to mention, I think the fashion direction for Osana is frankly hideous and easily the worst out of all the rivals. I mean, those polka dots? Someone please call the fashion police, because those things are a crime against knee socks. Oh, and not only that, but polka dot scrunchies too? Maybe I just have a personal vendetta against polka dots, but they genuinely look so bad. And the scrunchies specifically weren't even a good design choice because they completely hide the ribbon that Osana also wears on top of that. No joke, I only realized she had a ribbon in her hair after Yandere Dev showed that clip of Osana coming back to school with short hair after you complete the first week without killing her, and I was like, oh, that looks really nice actually. And then I paid closer attention at her original design and I realized, wait, she's always had that. But the polka dot scrunchies were so hideous that it blinded me from noticing them. That to me is bad design because you're doing too much. So as usual, I'm going to be running through my four goals. Creating a more compelling design, writing a more compelling personality, and before you go into the comments to tell me, Oh, but Callie, you dum-dum. She's meant to be unlikable and a tsundere. You can't take that away from her. I know. I'm not gonna change her personality because unlike Ayano and Taro, Osana actually has one. I'm only going to be providing more context to her personality so that we as an audience can sympathize with her better. And I will also be fleshing out her backstory and connection to Senpai, and finally, talking about how I would implement this version into the game for the gameplay. For Osana's design, I wanted to give her a theme that was more representative of her than just polka dots. So I went through some of her distinctive character traits and remembered that she is a huge cat lover. The moment I thought of that, everything just fell into place. And I was actually quite surprised Yandev didn't think of this concept himself. If you've ever known a cat, you would know that cats are basically some of the biggest tsunderes in real life. They want your attention and will literally attack you for not paying enough attention to them. But when you do give them attention, suddenly you're just clingy and oh god, just leave me alone. And I think that fits Osana perfectly. So with that in mind, I decided to give Osana some more cat-like features, starting with her face. I gave her a rounder face shape because cats tend to have round faces, and I also gave her cat-shaped eyes that I think also make her look sassier and fiercer. I also gave her this lip shape that is highly popular in South Korea and can be seen in some K-pop idols because it makes her look more cat-like as well. It also gives her a nice pout that I think would work well with her tsundere personality. For her hair, I wanted to give her a wilder appearance to better complement her feisty personality, so something more voluminous and tousled. I thought of cat's whiskers, and particularly in long-haired breeds, how they have poofy fur around their face, and I wanted to emulate that in Osana's design to further hammer home that feline aesthetic. So I gave her a bit more spiky floof framing her face, which was inspired by the 90s cat's costumes, the live stage one, not the uncanny movie, which I thought would look unique and also added that volume I was hoping for, while making her hair look more fiery and feline-like overall. I thought of possibly using her hair to make pseudo cat ears as well, and I initially tried doing that with her twin tails, but I don't think it really worked. I could have shaped the ears using her fringes, but the problem with that is that she still had twin tails coming off from either side of her head, where those ears would be, which would have drowned them out just like the ribbon. And to be honest, I'm not a fan of her twin tails. I think they're absurdly long, and yes, I know that they are that way for a specific elimination method, but from a design perspective, the fact that there's two of them really weighs her design down because it gives her a very flat-looking silhouette. So despite how controversial this is going to be, in the end, I decided, F the twin tails, I'll do what I want, and I dropped them altogether. Instead, I went for a long, sleek ponytail. This would still allow the hair-specific elimination methods to happen, but also complete her feline-like looks by sort of emulating a cat's tail. And I was super happy with that, so I decided to stick with it. My version of Osana is also a gamer, which I will get into later, so naturally she needs cat ear headphones, which also suit her aesthetic perfectly. I also considered using her hair bow to emulate cat ears at first, but I was already planning on giving her a neck bow, which, fun fact, is actually her uniform necktie. So it seemed a bit excessive and I didn't end up doing it. I thought the neck bow would be a nice touch because it made me think of Murray from Aristocats, and cats also like playing with strings and ribbons a lot, so I thought it was pretty solid thematic association. But tell me what you guys think. For her knee socks, I thought of these cat knee socks that used to be all the rage on Tumblr back when people were still on Tumblr. And I think they're super adorable and fits her theme, so you know I had to give Asana those socks and get rid of those god-awful polka dots. Every time I see them, I think of old ladies' underwear and I hate it. I also got a lot of people telling me in my previous video that I made Senpai too buff and that I designed him to suit my own personal preferences, and listen, I literally said in that video that I'm no good at drawing men and women and kids and animals and anything really. I'm still learning and figuring things out as I go along, and I was only updating him to fit the current trend of what most girls seem to prefer in guys. Are some of those things also something I personally enjoy? Yes, but it's not fair to say that I just made him my type because he's really not. And I get it, when your stuff gets pushed to a bigger audience, you're obviously going to get more criticism and feedback for it. And despite the initial hit to my pride, I definitely felt that it helped me improve my work overall. Another common criticism I get is that I make the waist too thin, and looking back at some of my previous work, I can definitely see where they're coming from. I still struggle to visualize the body on a three-dimensional plane, so often I just end up drawing them from a two-dimensional perspective, which is fine if the character is fully facing the camera, but once they start twisting and moving, that's when it gets tricky for me. Either I end up twisting a 2D body that looks really weird because it has no depth, or I make the pose too safe and not dynamic enough. Ah, the struggles of an artist. Well, I did my best with Osana. I spent a lot of time off camera doing a ton of different adjustments to her waist and legs, and I don't think people talk about this enough, but why are feet so hard to figure out? And why are skirts so hard to draw? I just can't make it look right. But yeah, once the lines and everything were all done, I got to coloring. As I've said before, I absolutely love Osana's original color scheme, so I decided to run with it. I tried to pick a skin shade that was derived from that same persimmon color and make the entire thing appear more coherent, and on top of that, I also used the color that was originally meant for her scrunchies and knee socks to color in her headphones. I imagine Osana would be the same age as Yan-chan, so I gave her the same uniform color, but otherwise, I pretty much didn't change anything. So that's the design component down. Let's talk about her personality and backstory. So Osana is a tsundere. I hate that, but you guys know that. But that is also all we've got, so we're running with it. As I've said before, I won't actually be changing her personality, just giving more depth to it, I guess. We know that Osana is a fiery, feisty girl with a sharp tongue and standoffish attitude. Around Senpai, she's downright mean, and deep down, it's actually because she likes him and doesn't want him to find out. This in itself presents a fallacy. If she's mean to him because she doesn't want him to find out, then why would she confess to him after she's been so mean to him? What makes her think that after she's been such an asshole to him, he's just going to be like, "Oh yeah, all those times you insulted me and put me down and made me feel like shit? Yeah, none of that matters anymore. Yes, you never apologized to me or cared about how I felt being treated like that, but the great Deku Tree is watching, so I have to say yes." Like, how does she think that's gonna go down? The fact that Senpai actually accepts her confession in the game is also really funny to me because it makes me think that he has a humiliation kink. So here's my take on it. Osana behaves so bitterly and angrily towards Senpai because he shut her out. I mentioned this briefly in my Fixing Senpai video, and for some context, in my rewrite for him, he and his sister have a very troubled home life with an alcoholic and neglectful father who regularly gets very aggressive and physical and forced Taro into the role of being her sister's parental figure, basically taking over the role of his father in the house. This is something he's very secretive about, and because he doesn't want anyone to find out, especially not Osana, he started distancing himself from her. Obviously, she notices that he's pushing her away, so she tried to save their friendship, but the harder she tries, the further away he gets. She doesn't want to lose him because she's always had a crush on him, and on top of that, he was her first and closest friend, so she tries everything to get him to pay attention to her. Unfortunately, that meant being mean and starting arguments with him, because that was the only way she could get a reaction from him and also get his undivided attention. Deep down, she knows it's destructive, but she also doesn't know what else to do. She even tried getting into the things he enjoys so that they would have something nice to talk about, like playing video games. But he's got new friends in the martial arts club and would rather play with them. This hurt her deeply because she felt that he abandoned her for newer friends, and it further incentivizes her awful behavior toward him because she felt betrayed. So she throws herself into the video game she bought, desperate to connect with him through his gaming servers and practicing hard to increase her skills to impress him. However, in doing that, she actually finds that she genuinely enjoys playing video games. Eventually, she stopped playing for him and started playing because she just genuinely likes it. Eventually, after seeing people stream video games online, she decided to try doing it herself and became quite a popular streamer. Hence, the cat ear headphones. Implementation-wise, that's also why she isn't really interested in joining any clubs and would rather just go straight home. I imagine her streamer persona being like the gremlin side of D.Va from Overwatch, just running on Mountain Dew, Doritos, and pure gamer rage. While writing that, this meme immediately came to mind, and I think that it is the perfect visual representation of what I mean. Obviously, she's a very pretty girl, she's fun to watch, and she looks like the perfect waifu, so she has a lot of male fans. I'm sure you're probably seeing where I'm going with this. Instead of her stalker liking her because she looks like an anime character he's obsessed with, he's actually a huge fan of her and became extremely obsessed with her. I think that would be a lot stronger and more straightforward reasoning for why she has a stalker, and it still allows us to play that stealth mission retrieving her cat from the stalker's house. It also gets rid of that extremely unnecessary addition of pretty girl Miyuki, which should hopefully make the game run better. Here's my proposal. Leading up to the deadline, Asana would be attempting to reconcile with Taro through several kind gestures. For instance, making a bento box for him. Maybe getting him a meaningful gift and writing him apologetic letters to try and soften him up as much as she can before asking him to meet at the cherry blossom tree. This is where the player comes in. We can snoop around and figure out her plan and then work to sabotage these attempts and ruin the relationship between her and Senpai even more. However, keeping with the concept that Asana is the tutorial rival, these are more meant for us to figure out the game mechanics, so it doesn't really have a major impact on the story regarding whether or not Senpai would accept her confession. This is because Osana has essentially been sabotaging herself the entire time with her attitude, and Taro's response would always be to reject her. If the player is smart enough to realize this and simply work to increase their own relationship with Senpai, which would massively help against the more challenging rivals where you are at higher risk of losing him, they will be rewarded by lowering this probability that Senpai would actually accept the other rival's confessions. However, if the player chooses to kill Osana, you will be eliminating a rival, yes, but it will negatively impact Senpai. You've essentially just killed his childhood best friend, and even if they had been drifting apart for years and he's thoroughly convinced she hates him, it's still a shocking turn of events. Because we're going for a psychological thriller route, focusing more on mental health, morality, and social games, I think killing Osana would make it more difficult for the player moving forward. Not only would it make romancing Senpai more difficult, with less affection points being rewarded than before, and immediately disqualify the player from achieving the best ending, which is the pacifist route. Senpai would blame himself for her death and feel guilty for not trying to reconcile with her when he had the chance. Losing her would only cause him to put up his walls even more. He knows how it feels now to have someone close to him truly be taken away. He would be more hesitant in getting close to other people, lest they get taken away too. Now, trying to keep Senpai this way would lead to a darker, more toxic route, but one the player should be able to explore anyway, because I think it would fit the kind of game this is. A yandere simulator. I think we should be given a more realistic view on yanderes and the implications of trying to own someone by force. He may not know it was you who did it, but by killing everyone around him he was close to, you were the one who damaged him. Could you really live with that? In my previous video, I suggested that if you befriend each rival, they could contribute a unique value to Yan-chan to help her overcome her yandere condition. If you manage to collect all the values, you essentially unlock the best ending where Yan-chan willingly returns to the psych ward to work on herself and become whole, and we get to learn her real name. If you're confused about what I'm going on about, I suggest watching this video for context. For Osana though, the value I decided on was friendship. This is a mutual exchange. Not only are we learning how to be a good friend from Osana and what it's like to have a friend, we also help her reflect on her own behaviors and realize what a bad friend she's being to Taro. Of course, if you end up befriending Osana, this will come with several advantages. First of all, the confession at the end of the week will be completely platonic. She realizes that he wouldn't be happy with her, and maybe even consider that he might be happier with you, because you're such a good person. So her meeting will only really be her kind of trying to figure out why he shut her out in the first place, which is still a win condition. Second, she might even put in a good word for you to Taro, giving you an advantage in the following weeks. Third, Osana, like Senpai's other friends, can give you meaningful insight on Senpai that you couldn't get from those other friends. Fourth, if you maintain your relationship well enough, she might actually help you against the upcoming rivals. So, my proposal is, it's possible for Osana to become our friend and an additional support to us and our psychological struggles later on. Of course, the player is still free to pursue the darker route, following their heart's darkest desires and descend into madness and horror, really experiencing that psychological thriller aspect. But again, that's up to the individual player, and I see value in both. I think it also gives more weight on the different elimination methods rather than just letting them be feature creep. For instance, instead of having school atmosphere drop based on the number of murder, it should be based on how the student dies. The more gruesome the murder, the greater the psychological impact will be on the school overall, but especially Taro. Think about it. The thought of someone dying on school premises from suicide would be much less terrifying to your health than someone apparently being yanked into an air vent. You could be next. So, whether the player wants to do a redemption story or become a serial killer in a high school is totally up to them. And because this is an Osana rewrite, you're probably wondering, what about Raiberu? Let's be honest, the only reason Raiboru is in the game is because Yandere Dev is trying to artificially make the game harder and force the players down a direction he prefers. I guess Raiboru could work as either a matchmaking candidate for Asana because it's so obvious that Raiboru is head over heels for her, a really big fan, or both. Let me know if you guys want me to include Raiboru in this new narrative as well, or if you think we should just scrap her. I can see an argument for either side. But this is the final look for Asana. I'm really happy with how she turned out. You guys have really helped me improve my art and motivated me to push myself to keep doing better. Let me know what you think of her design. The next character on my list is Amai, so hit the subscribe button if you don't want to miss that. And that is the end of my video. Thank you so much for watching and for all the incredible fan art you guys made. It always makes my day to see all the nice comments you leave on my videos, and it really helps to get my videos out there as well. We're almost at 20k! I don't think it has really sunk in yet, but I'm also trying not to think too much about it. I just want to keep making content and trying things I've always wanted to do, but never had the motivation to. So there's definitely more to come from me. And I would really appreciate it if you joined me on this journey of YouTube self-actualization. If you want to support me, I've got a Ko-fi account, links in the description. Subscribe to become an official Kalimari. Follow me on all my social media. Check out my comic, because that would make me really happy. And I will see you guys in the next video. Goodbye!